Hello, good morning. I must begin with three apologies. My first apology, I'm sorry I speak no Spanish. It is terribly rude. If I could have done better last night and prepared this in Spanish, I would have. But my apologies that I can't. My second apology is the title of my presentation. This title is pretentious. How can teaching artists, a phrase that you maybe never even have heard of before, pretend to be the solution to the problem of the arts? So I'll begin with a big vision of this idea of artists who teach, a new kind of artist that enables us to change our organizations from the inside out. And then we'll get down to the details of what this looks like in the US. And I'll be giving examples from the US, which is my background. And my third apology is, I must warn you, I am completely not a musician. I know nothing about music. And I protect this ignorance very carefully because it is my greatest asset to share with the world of symphony orchestras. I'll give you a little bit of my background in a moment, but first I want to thank our hosts. I thank the foundation for inviting me into the house that is older than my country. And I thank the association for taking care to be the learning leader for a field. The association we have in the US is very important to our field. And it has helped our field not fall so far behind the changes in our public, which is part of the message that I'll share with you today. And also a small apology to the translators in the other room. I come from New York. I'll try to slow down. At least I've come to a city where people talk as fast as New Yorkers talk, just in a different language. But I want to share with you some things that we have learned in the US that, according to the research that was just suggested, may be some timely information. In the US, our orchestras are in worse trouble than yours. They have a smaller share of public interest, they have less tradition, and we have significantly less background for young people, so that as they grow up, they feel they belong in the arts. In fact, I use a term called the art club in the US, which is the people of the population who feel they belong in the arts. They understand the arts, they identify themselves as someone who loves the arts. In the United States, this is 6% of our population are in the art club, and only half of that is in the classical music club. So that is 3% of the US population identifies as at home inside classical music. And that 3% is getting old. So we're in serious trouble for quite a long time. And so we have had to start experimenting before you have had to start experimenting with ways to not dumb down, not make more stupid our work, but open up our work so more people can come inside and get what we know is there. And this is where the role of the teaching artist becomes so important. So a little background on me. I was, as you maybe can tell, a Broadway actor. I was in many plays, but I did not like doing 8 performances a week over and over. You in music, you don't have to worry about this unless you perform with the Lion King. It's very boring to play the same part 8 times a week for month after month. So on the side, I experiment with something they were just starting calling teaching artist at Lincoln Center. This is 1979, because they found that 500,000 children were coming to Lincoln Center every year and not having much of an experience. In fact, the head of Lincoln Center said in the first year, he saw lots of little children going into a building at Lincoln Center, and he pulled one boy aside and said, "So," this is a teenage boy, "so you're here at Lincoln Center?" Kid goes, "Yeah." "What are you here to see?" "I don't know, it's a school trip." And he thought, we have to do better than this. We have to prepare our audiences better so that when they come inside these buildings, they are able to do this important thing: make a personally relevant connection inside the music. You'll hear me say that phrase several times. This is our goal, to help people be able to make a personally relevant connection inside the artwork. That is the goal. And according to all the research I read in the US, that is the single thing that brings people back. In fact, the research on people who renew their season subscription to symphony orchestras in the US, the number one reason they write a big check again the next year is because in the last year, they had a significant emotional or spiritual experience inside the music. So if we are going to survive, we must open wider than just 3% those who can go inside the music and make a personally relevant connection. Who is good at helping that? Teaching artists. So this is the idea I share, is the techniques we have developed in the US because we had to. We weren't very brilliant, we were just desperate. The field began in about 1980 when President Ronald Reagan cut money from music education programs in schools. And the arts community looks around and says, oh no, we're going to have a generation of young people grow up with no feeling for the arts. They won't, no one will belong to the arts club except a very thin percentage of very wealthy children. In fact, the orchestra will become an elite museum art form, not full of the muscle of popularity it belongs. So arts organizations, starting in 1980, began to send artists into schools, quite a lot of them. They paid for it themselves. And fairly soon, foundations, thank you foundations, began to support sending artists into schools to give a whole generation some feeling for the arts. We found out, after about 10 years of research, that a broad and shallow exposure to the arts did not make much difference. The big dream and the early foundation grants were all about, you know, give children exposure and in the future they will become subscribers to orchestras. Research said, no. They have an okay experience, but it doesn't change their sense of the art club. They didn't feel they belonged in the arts. It took more work. It took more technique, more skills on the part of the teaching artist to be able to go past giving information and then hoping people have a good experience, but to learn how to actually support this amazing capacity to go inside Mahler, to go inside Beethoven, and find something there that matters to your life. That is the goal of the teaching artist. And over the 35, 40 years of teaching artistry in the US, we have developed more techniques for how to do this. Teaching artistry has grown up in the US. It's now considered a profession. There are between 30 and 40,000 teaching artists in the US who make a significant part of their living as teaching artists. They work in all the different fields, and in the classical music and orchestra world, it's a little bit different. It may be the hardest one, but they've learned, in a minute I'll talk about how teaching artists live within US orchestras. But first, I'm about to do something you should never do at the beginning of a keynote speech, which is give you an extremely boring definition of the idea you're sharing. I'll let our translators translate this for you. It's way too many words, but I try to get everything we know into one definition. A teaching artist is an artist whose artistry expands to include the skills, curiosities, habits of mind of an educator in order to achieve a wide variety of learning goals in, through, and about the arts with a wide range of learners. Let me share, point out some of the features of this role of teaching artist. So, teaching artist is an artist, not used to be an artist, now an artist. That's important. The mind, the presence, is taught in the real moment. We have a thing in the US we call the law of 80%. That's very important for teaching artists. The law of 80%. I call it a law because that sounds important. And that number 80% sounds like I did some research. No, it's a made-up number. But the truth of the law of 80% for teaching artists is 80% of what you teach is who you are. 80% is you, the artist, in the moment. Not the information you exchange, but the quality of your listening, the way you make connections with what the learners observe, the way you discover things with your participants, the way you are an artist with the participants teaches more about what it means to be inside art than three piles of books. So you need to be an artist. And it's an artist whose artistry expands. When people first learn about teaching artists, they think, oh, so you're a musician, and then you learn some extra things you do with short people that are good in schools. They always, kids like this, or this is fun for kids. That's not it. We learned that's not enough in the US. It's okay for some musicians. It's better than nothing. But a real teaching artist, you stand on your artistry and expand it. This is why you never talk down as if someone is not so smart or doesn't know anything about Beethoven. You stand on your artistry and open it wider. We'll do a little experiment in a few minutes. So you expand your artistry to include the skills of an educator. Inherent in artistry is the wish to connect. It's just another kind of connection. It is different than playing with perfect technique. It is the same as fully communicating with your artistry, just using different skills. With the skills, and I put in curiosities, because it's not just about you and them, it's about discovery. It's about your interest in what people bring to the encounter with you. They come as musically competent people. They may not know about Palestrina, but they know a lot about music. And we must be curious about that. I taught at Juilliard for, this is a little of my background, when I was bored on Broadway and working a little bit as a teaching artist, after a few years, I was hired to start the teaching artist program at Juilliard. This was my first entry into the strange subculture of classical music that is still pretty much a strange subculture to me. And for those students, I had them for 2 years, 1 year in class where we investigated practices and principles, and 1 year where they were partnered in a school in Harlem, and they had to go see the same kids every week for a whole year, develop a real set of understandings of how to gauge those kids. The scariest assignment I used to give them, and they would lie awake at night for weeks in advance in fear of this assignment, and it was that they had to get on a New York City public bus and engage people in substantive conversations about classical music before they got off. They thought people would hit them. They were terrified. What happens when you share classical music with the general public on a bus? And invariably, they came to the same conclusion with great relief. They would say, you know, if you start by connecting with people about music, they have a whole big musical life. And if you connect with that, they become curious about my small slice of music that I know in great depth. They then want to come into my world. But if I sit next to someone and start talking about retrograde patterns in the second movement of the Bartok Symphony, they maybe will hit me. They reject that idea. So it is wholehearted, genuine curiosity about how music lives in the world and how it connects to what I love. And habits of mind and action. It isn't that I'm a musician, oh yeah, now I'm an educator. It is, I think like an educator. I'm constantly looking for ways to capture the moment of musical aliveness. I'm interested in what the person next to me in the grocery store is presenting me with an opportunity. When I'm with a group, I have many tools to pick up in the moment, and I think like an educator as well as thinking like a musician. In order to achieve a wide variety of learning goals. The main learning goal, at least with orchestras, is to prepare audiences to have a fuller experience of classical music. But let me just give you a hint. There's many other learning goals in the US that orchestras are using teaching artists to explore. I'll give you just a few suggestions of this. The South Dakota Symphony lived next to a gigantic Indian reservation, but had no relationship with this gigantic neighbor. They created a compositional project led by teaching artists where the musical traditions of the Lakota people and the symphony language, they co-created a piece of music that has now made for long-term relationship between the symphony orchestra and the many Native American tribes that surround where they live. In the Pittsburgh Symphony, they have a long-term relationship with a health facility where the musicians work with disabled young people, they work with old people with dementia, and over time, they have learned how to achieve medical benefits through the quality of their musical intervention. And perhaps most dramatically, the Royal Liverpool Philharmonic Orchestra, I can't claim it as American, but they have made, I think, the biggest commitment to community of any major orchestra in the world, where they have a regular investment in West Everton, which is the poor part of the city. And those musicians now rehearse in a facility they've purchased there with the public interacting with them. They've created an El Sistema-inspired program there. They work in youth education. And when musicians, you know, the 5 minutes in rehearsal before you start, when the musicians are talking to one another and, you know, kind of waiting for everyone to show up, they did a little research. 85% of the time, the musicians, when they are chatting, are talking about their work in West Everton. And they are the first ones to claim their work in West Everton has completely changed forever their understanding of what their symphony is. And they have a dramatically healthy relationship with the city and with the funding bodies of Liverpool. The funding bodies, the municipal funding, they now see the orchestra as a profound benefit to the entirety of their community, not just the wealthy set that can afford to attend. So many goals, and we could list more and more of the ways that US orchestras are using teaching artists to accomplish things, new relationships, eventually maybe new audiences. One other example, why would an orchestra develop an in-depth partnership with a prison? Carnegie Hall, not an orchestra, but a little like an orchestra, has spent many years now working in Sing Sing Penitentiary, which is maximum security prison just outside New York City. These men will be there a long time. So they learn to play instruments. They've now learned to play them well. They engage in compositional projects. 2 years ago, they organized compositions by the inmates for woodwind quintet, and they had a concert for the rest of the prisoners in Sing Sing. And last year, they made compositions upon the theme of Duke Ellington's Sacred Songs. Why does Carnegie Hall do this? They are not selling any seats to these guys. Not now, not ever. And when you ask them, what they say is, we have much to learn. We have much to learn about how to take what we know and make it useful in the world. Not make it less interesting, but make it more powerful in the lives of more people. And they will tell you the Sing Sing Prison Project, what they learned has changed the way they think about what they have to give to the world. And they have started a number of programs that get a lot of funding in which the knowledge of classical music is opened much wider. One other example is the Lullaby Project, where they're teaching artists of classical music, work with young women who are pregnant, single young women in homeless shelters and prisons. And the Carnegie Hall teaching artists work with them for the women to compose lullabies for their babies to come. The reason? It has been shown that for medical health results, young women under so much stress do not bond very well with the babies. And it's bad for the babies to come into the world amid so much tension. But their researchers show that the lullaby process and a regular practice of singing that lullaby for a new baby reduces the stress in measurable ways. The Lullaby Project is now rolling out to 17 cities across the US. They want every shelter in New York City to have a Lullaby Project, not because art is wonderful, but because it is so healthy for the mother and the baby. Teaching artists, taking what they know and applying it to another learning end. And the last line, what is superb about teaching artists is their skill at reaching anyone, taking what they know, and being able to include anyone, even to the degree as at the New York Philharmonic, where they're working with young people with serious autism, people with dementia, people who are usually not reachable by the arts, teaching artists, expanding what they know, bring them into their musical capacity. All right, you're spared this. You don't have to look at it anymore. I'll tell a story. A story I like to tell a lot because it was the worst moment of my professional life. Live on television, I was being interviewed on a morning talk show. So, as you can imagine, it was a very peppy young woman. And she said to me, "Eric, we're just about at the end of our interview, so can you give us a very quick and clear distinction between art and entertainment?" I appreciate the laugh. What would you have said? Well, I will tell you the hogwash that poured out of me for 2 minutes on live television was a humiliation to humankind. I had no idea. In fact, to tell you the truth, you know the experience of like you're on and there's no getting out of it? You just sometimes grab one idea and go with it. You know, whether it's good or not, you just go with it. Well, the one idea that went through my head was someone had once told me, if you are ever dying on live television, just don't stop talking. Then they can't turn it into sound bites that will haunt you for the rest of your life. So unbroken sentences without breaths for 2 minutes waiting for the light to go off. At the end of which I thought, I never want to go through that again. What is the distinction? And I came up with this, that entertainment is, please God, not the opposite of art. We are in big trouble if art and entertainment are opposed to one another. What distinguishes entertainment is that it happens within what you already know. Whatever your reaction, you laugh, you cry, you get excited, underneath it, entertainment says, yes, the world is the way you think it is. And that feels great, to have highly skilled people confirming my sense of the way the world is. Fantastic. I'll pay a lot of money for that at a Pops concert. Feels great, very exciting. Art, on the other hand, happens outside of what we already know. Inherent in the artistic experience is the capacity to expand your sense of the way the world is or might be. The art is in the verb, not in the noun. It is this amazing human capacity to expand the sense of the possible. That's what teaching artists focus on. In America, we live in a culture that has very little interest in expanding the sense of the possible. With such easy, inexpensive, highly stimulating, gratifying entertainment available anytime I want, cheap, why would I want to go to all the trouble of expanding my sense of the way the world is or might be? Unless we can activate the pleasure people feel in that process, inside classical music, discover something that expands their sense of the way the world is or might be, if we can't do that, we're going down. That's really all we've got. You know, our concerts cost 80 euros, 100 euros. It's a lot of money. There's a lot more stimulating entertainment, ready, fast, pleasurable, satisfying, confirms my sense of the way the world is. unless we can activate this ancient human power of artistic engagement, we're going down. Yes, the art club can do that. But those not in the art club, they struggle. I'm not a classical music guy. I go to the symphony orchestra. I don't always have such a great experience. There's a lot of times I'm sitting there thinking I'd rather be at a baseball game. Half the price. Hot dogs. A lot available pleasures in that. If I'm not connecting, I wish someone had been there to help me get inside that Webern that would let me find a personally relevant connection. And I'll tell you what we do. People like me, people kind of part-timers in the art club, is we act very polite. When it's not working, we sit, we pointed in the right direction. You know, we kind of look, there's stuff to do. It's not very interesting. You know, you look at who's attractive. You know, you sort of notice all the bows are going at the same time. It's not very exciting, but you think because I smiled and nodded that I made personally relevant connections inside that music, and I did not. In fact, you did very little to help me be successful. And the work of the teaching artist is that there's a lot of things we can do to help people become successful at that crucial interface when it's just you and the music and what you can do. And here's how we need to think about art. It isn't in the nouns. Let's say we've got the same three people sitting next to each other. Sorry, I'm going to be pointing at you. And they're seeing Mahler's First Symphony. First person having a fantastic experience. Hearing a kind of understanding of spiritual capacity he never heard before. Next person over, you know, kind of having a good time. It's the melodic passages are beautiful, it's very relaxing, going to take little side trips to think about things at work, but coming back and having a really relaxing, entertaining experience. Third person over was dragged by a spouse, does not like Mahler, and is waiting it out. The same noun up here, but based on the verbs of what these people can do with their own artistic selves, it turns into a work of art, a work of entertainment, or a nightmare. So our focus is on activating the innate artistry of others. And teaching artists are good at that. Enough talk. It is time for an activity. This activity works best if you take some notes. You don't have to, it's not a classroom. I will be looking. But if we're gonna do a little experiment, and it helps if you take some notes. So here's the experiment. Something very familiar, I think. We're going to have a live performance of a work of art. Very familiar. And we're going to do it four times. Same work of art, not so familiar. And we're going to do a different preparation before it each time. And look at what is the relationship between the preparation and your experience inside the artwork. This is the teaching artist gamble, that there is something you can do that will enrich the quality of the encounter with that artwork, okay? So the experiment is, I'll perform the artwork, and after it, you take some quick notes that tell the truth of what happened inside you. This is not be nice to Eric. This is tell the truth. This is, I made a grocery list, I noticed that my feet itched, whatever, or I noticed this line. Whatever it is, tell the truth. And we're going to do it four times and then look back on the four experiences. And because I can't do anything musically, I bring you into my art form of theater. It's sometimes a little easier to see something outside of your own art form. So tell the truth with your notes, and if you're not taking notes, have a really good memory of exactly what really happened in there. Okay, first one, no preparation. Standard procedure out there in the art world, where you pay your money, you come in, you sit down, and there it is. So we'll do that one first. The Red Wheelbarrow by William Carlos Williams. So much depends upon a red wheelbarrow glazed with rainwater beside the white chickens.
Thank you.
Take your notes. Tell the truth. What happened in there? Tell the truth. Okay. Anybody see the film Men in Black? You know, they have that gizmo that you go pop, and people completely forget the experience they just had. So I need one of those now. They're like, pop, you never heard that poem before. All right, here we go. Second time. And this time I will do a little preparation, then go into the poem. When it's done, quick notes on your experience in the poem. Did the preparation enrich the quality of your encounter with it? In a moment, I'm going to speak the poem The Red Wheelbarrow by William Carlos Williams, one of the most famous poems of the 20th century in the US. Williams was born in Rutherford, New Jersey. He went through high school as a poet. He went to the University of Pennsylvania and couldn't decide whether to become a doctor or a poet. His parents wanted him to become a doctor. He decided to become both. He became quite a famous poet, but fell out of favor. He had been affiliated with the Imagist poets, and particularly Ezra Pound, but he fell out of favor until the 1950s, when he was brought back to public acclaim because the Beat poets found great pleasure in him, particularly Allen Ginsberg, to whom he was a strong mentor, and he continued writing poems until his death in 1963. The Red Wheelbarrow. So much depends upon a red wheelbarrow glazed with rainwater beside the white chickens. Thank you. Notes tell the truth. How did the preparation affect your experience? Okay, here comes the third one. There's only four, don't worry. This would be the Men in Black moment. Pop! Never heard that before. Here's the third preparation. The opening lines of The Red Wheelbarrow set the tone for the rest of the poem, since the poem is composed of one sentence broken into various intervals. It's truthful to say that so much depends on each line of the poem. This is because the form of the poem is also its meaning, and by the end of the poem, the image of a wheelbarrow is seen as the actual poem, as in a painting, when one sees an image of an apple, but the apple represents an object in reality, and at the same time, the painting of the apple represents an actual work of art. In line three, the vivid word red lights up the scene. Notice how the monosyllabic words in the third line changes, elongates it, giving a chopping quality to it. And when wheel and barrow are broken into separate lines, it's as if a scientist were deconstructing the components of an image. In the fifth line, the literary device of assonance is used in the word glazed to evoke another painterly image. And the last lines offer up the final brushstroke in this still life poem when white is used in contrast to the earlier red, and the unusual view of the ordinary wheelbarrow has provided a dissected image and a redefinition of the very concept of poetry. The red wheelbarrow. So much depends upon a red wheelbarrow glazed with rainwater beside the white chickens. Notes. Tell the truth. How did the intervention affect the quality of your experience? Okay,
last one.
Pop, never heard it before. I recently learned the actual story of the circumstances that prompted William Carlos Williams to write the poem, The Red Wheelbarrow. He was a pediatrician back in the days when doctors made house calls, and he had this one patient who lived on a farm, a young girl who had a serious illness that had her teetering on the brink of life and death. For several weeks, she was just, they didn't know whether she was gonna make it or not. And after he examined her one day, he sat beside her and thought about what her days are like. And he looked down the length of her bed to this window at the foot of her bed. And on this rainy day, he looked out that window and he saw a wheelbarrow in the rain, and he went home and he wrote, "So much depends upon a red wheelbarrow glazed with rainwater beside the white chickens." Quick notes. Okay, we put an end to our moderately manipulative social science experiment to take a look at the data that we collect. For those of you that wrote down, look at your responses to the first reading, the no preparation reading. If we were having a real workshop now, I would ask for suggestions from you. Probably some of them would be things like, what happened? It went by so fast, or I didn't know how to be with it, or I caught something about a wheelbarrow, and then there was something about chickens, or maybe somebody knows the poem and had like a memory experience, but let me tell you, it's you don't know how to be with the thing. And I'll just hit the pause button here for a moment. As the non-music guy, could you please play pieces on your program more than once sometimes? I don't know how to be with these things. They're all new to me. And so I spend like the first time, you know, first listening, figuring out what this thing is and how to be with it and what it's made of and how to get a sense of it. And at the end of it, I am ready to hear it. And I will never hear it again for the rest of my life. In fact, you don't even tell me how long these things are. I know they're kind of added up. They fit the right length of time. But I listen really differently to something that's 4 minutes versus something that's 14 minutes. And I often don't know how to effectively apply my attention. You may have had some of that experience in the first hearing where you're kind of running behind it. Some people maybe gave up. It only lasts a few seconds and you probably gave up. Young people, they hear, you know, they see someone stand like this and say, the red wheelbarrow, they already check out. So we're doing nothing to support your coming into this artwork that I love, putting it out there, and probably for most of you, failing. The second hearing, the one where I talked about the poet, standard operating procedure in the classical music world, where the belief that by telling you some stuff, particularly about the composer, this will help the listener make personally relevant connections. Here's what's poignant. People who are in the art club, it works for them. They can actually take in information and translate it into enhanced experience. People outside the art club can't do it. They receive that information, it pushes them up in the head. They don't know what they're supposed to do with that information when the artwork comes up. And so what they feel is stupid, or in this case, maybe a little irritated. All of that information that didn't directly pay off. A true story, a few years ago, I heard the Oregon Symphony was performing a Dvorak symphony, and sitting behind me was like a 22-year-old dating couple, pretty rare. So I'm like eavesdropping up a storm to see like what's going on back there. And they were all dressed up. It's like they were auditioning for, this is the kind of couple we are. You know, we're the kind of couple that gets cheap tickets and comes to the symphony. And I can tell it's going really well. Until they opened the program and got to the biographical information on Dvorak. And for the first time, this deathly quiet falls over their date. And like they're quiet for a minute, I can hear the guy starting to kind of squirm in his seat. And what he finally did was he started reading the biography in a highly artificial British accent to put it down. Dvorak was born in such and such a year. The thing the orchestra had offered to help the audience, the only way this guy could make a positive evening was by rejecting it overtly to reclaim the positiveness of his date. And in fact, we do that with love. We think, this will be helpful. What harm could come from this? Harm can come from that. People outside the art club do not process that the same way that people with a background in this music do. And you can tell a little bit from your notes on how the poet's biography affected your hearing, which is probably not much. Maybe irritated you, maybe you found a word that could be useful, imagist. Well, maybe I'll try to apply that. Maybe something good will happen. But the connection was weak. Then there was the third listening, the academic approach. That was taken almost directly from an internet scholar trying to be useful, helping audiences connect to this poem. I don't know what happened to you, but you didn't look happy. Some people I've heard in the past are having a flashback to bad university experiences. There's a tone that says, you should see it the way I see it. And if you don't, you're dumb, or you're less, or you have to overcome what I have set you up to look for. Maybe you found something in there if you're a really good listener. But basically, I made it harder for you to make a personally relevant connection inside the artwork that I love, and in this case, have been a scholar for many years to be able to share. Very common pre-show lecture. Works for those in the art club, does not work for the, in the US, 97% of the public that might find its way into the building. And then there's the fourth one that I was representing as the teaching artist approach, which is that I had a different purpose. I opened up a story. It had one main metaphor in it of a frame, because I wanted you to, that was my entry point, a term we'll look at in a moment, for you to enter the artwork through that notion of a framed image. I didn't tell you what depends on it. I didn't tell you how to interpret it. I invited you into the world of it and then trusted that your imaginative capacity, your artistry, could join this artwork as a colleague and make some meaning that was relevant to you. That's the way teaching artists work. Preparations is one of our most common tools that activate your innate artistic musical competence so that when the music plays, you can go in there and connect. What does that look like in real life? I'll give you an example. For a number of years, I worked at Tanglewood, which is the summer home of the Boston Symphony Orchestra, and my job was to help design the family concerts that happen over the course of the summer. And you know, 1,500 people show up and all ages, it's like crazy. And the head of Tanglewood hired me. She said, we do these family concerts, and if I hear Tubby the Tuba one more time, I'm going to kill myself. There has to be another way to do this. So we took a week before Tanglewood started to apply the tools of teaching artistry to a concert. One concert, the theme was a music derived from nature. The concert began with four young teaching artist conductors coming to the front of the stage and sort of sectioning off the orchestra, the audience, sort of saying, you know, you follow me. No words, you follow me. And the four-part orchestra audience then began a two-minute sound improvisation of a thunderstorm. Began, when you have 1,500 people doing that, it sounds like light rain. The rain built up a little bit. Then we're starting to get to the thunderclaps. And when you've got, you know, 500 kids swamping their chairs, you know, it's a big thunderclap. They then begin to do it in exactly the pattern that appears in the fourth movement of Beethoven's Sixth Symphony. The arc of the improvisation parallels that quite exactly, so that as the audience improvisation drops out, in comes the orchestra with the fourth movement of Beethoven's Sixth Symphony, and every kid can stay with it all the way through, because they're watching how Ludwig solved the problem that they just did. Experiential entry, tapping their innate competence in a complex and satisfying way, their artistry, to open up access to a major work of art. Here's another example. There was one concert, What Makes Music Heroic? Sound Heroic. So we had the orchestra play the world's most boring version of Twinkle, Twinkle, Little Star and asked for suggestions from the audience to turn it into a grand heroic statement. And whatever they called out, the orchestra did. Faster, not very heroic. Louder, not so good. They started coming up with more ideas. Finally, one little kid, I thought I was going to have to cheat and like yell this out from the back. But finally, one little kid yelled out, brass! So the brass played the theme. You could feel the audience go, oh yeah. Oh yeah, now we're on to something. They began to make more suggestions, and indeed, we came up with six things that the audience agreed makes for the heroic sound. We didn't tell them anything. We activated their musical curiosity and artistry about orchestration. So they developed six ideas that they then watched throughout the whole concert, how different composers used those six ideas in different ways. We never told them anything. Teaching artists, the goal is to activate the artistry of others, to tap their competence. Most Americans, this may not be true in Europe, but most Americans over age 9 feel artistically incompetent. Around age 9, something happens to people. Before age 9, you say to a kid, draw a cow. Kid goes right to work, makes a cow. My cow. I'm proud of my cow. This is maybe the best cow ever. It belongs at least on a refrigerator door. And then somewhere around 9 years and one day, you say, draw a cow. Kid goes, no, I suck at cows. I don't do cows. And every art form begins to fall off the kid's sense of competence. Our work as teaching artists is to strengthen that sense of competence before age 9 and to reactivate it after age 9 without hitting the tripwire of art. I'll give you an example of how hard that can be. I had a project where I worked with the board of directors of Federal Express, not the art crowd. And they wanted it to be about creativity. In fact, as a teaching artist, my most common job with businesses is creativity, but no art. Creativity, good. Competitive advantage, innovations for my company. But don't goop it up with all the touchy-feely stuff you artists deal with. I'll do this. They pay great. So the idea was, I had the table full, start with a highly competitive word game. So they're looking who's got more words. They're working as fast as they can. Then they had to go back and revise their words in a particular way. Then they had to go back one more time and revise their words according to an important personal experience they once had. About halfway through this step, they realized they were making something that looked suspiciously like a poem. But it was too late, because they were already, here's my word for art, making something they care about. They were constructing something of personal meaning. They had slipped into their artistry, and once that verb, that set of verbs is activated, people start doing what artists do. They want to finish it. They want it to be powerful. And at Federal Express, they wanted me to tell them which was the best. That's how they think. So the idea is teaching artists have developed a pedagogy that activates the innate verbs of art in all people. We stand on our dime as artists, but we have ways to open wide the invitation to come and join us in the belief that, in fact, what we have is extremely valuable. And thank heavens, they find out it is. They find out that, in fact, if you can get inside what Ludwig was doing in the fourth movement of Beethoven's Sixth Symphony, I want more of that. That has a particular kind of pleasure and satisfaction that is different than the video games, the things I do at work, the movies that I watch. It has a different feel. I want more of that. We had better succeed at that, because if not, that 3% is going to become 2%, is going to become 1%. And we can do it. We have the skills. I want to mention two of the tools that we've just experienced, just so they kind of planted in your head. One of them is the idea of entry point. For every work of art that we share with an audience, the normal way we work in preparation is we give audiences several things that might be useful or interesting to them. I'll say, pick one. Pick one aesthetic feature that has these two qualities. You love it. The law of 80%. You are excited at your sophisticated, mature experience stage. You love this aspect of the work of art. It maybe isn't the most important musicological feature, but it's the one that you love. And then match that with what you think might be powerful for this particular audience. So you select one entry point, not three, one, and you bring people in experientially, not through information. Information comes later, after you're interested. Imagine if I had given you the biography of William Carlos Williams after you had a good experience of that fourth hearing. You become curious, and research shows you would take in more information and you would retain it longer. The watchword is engagement before information. But in fact, mostly we use information as engagement, which only works for a small part of the population. So this notion of entry point, I've worked with many US orchestras, major orchestras. And on each program, they look for one entry point. What is the point of this program? What would all humans care about? Not just the 3% that understand why these four pieces of music are put together. I'll tell you, I don't get it most of the time. You know, I'll get it if they all are music composed in Venezuela. Like, that I'll get. But kind of the other ones where you got four pieces, to me it just looks like four pieces that fit the right amount of time. And I want more for my money than that. I want a journey that matters to me. I want a personally relevant journey. We give you that in theater, by God. A coherent journey. If I'm choosing not to go to a baseball game, but to go for this personally important experience, help me. Have the program take me somewhere in a way I can arrive at a place where I feel more human, even though I don't come in with the background that you do. Entry point is the way to do that. And I have several orchestras in the US that the marketing department insists on having an entry point for every program. And they build their advertising and their marketing strategies around it, and they invite the musicians into thinking about that entry point for the work they're going to do in the community and the conversations they're going to have. It gives a different kind of vitality. One of true confessions, and this would never happen in a Spanish orchestra, but let's just say in American orchestras, those musicians do not look very excited at the beginning of a performance. I'm a theater person. I look at them and I think, wow, it's a day at the office for them. And I spent 75 euros and they're already bored. I can tell when I go to work with a major orchestra, I'm working with the musicians, and within 10 minutes, I can tell which are the teaching artists in the group. By the quality of their attention, by the generosity of their engagement around new ideas that could enrich their musical lives. And the other 85%, I can pick them out too. Well, that's true in the audience as well. We can pick out the vitality, the sense of purpose, so that if in fact there is an entry point alive in this body of musicians, the whole event picks up energy, picks up focus. And some very traditional orchestras, would never happen in Spain, are nervous about doing unusual things. And I confess I have urged orchestras to do unusual things. Usually they won't do them because they're too terrifying. But even a simple one with the Philadelphia Orchestra, where it took me a year to get them to experiment with, before the performance, have a musician come to the front of the stage and for 3 minutes share something personal. about the program that's about to unfold. Not instructive, just some personal way in, a little bit like that story of the poem. They were afraid their traditional subscribers would scream and cancel their subscriptions. They're talking before a performance. Anyway, they finally did it, and they did this wonderful thing. They didn't tell the rest of the orchestra who was going to speak on any given night. So instead of sitting like dried sticks, they're like looking, they're awake. They're like looking around, you know, what's happening here? You know, and they'll see like, whoa, my God, it's the guy from the back of the viola section. I didn't know he could talk. And comes and tells this lovely little story, that in fact opens everyone up just a little bit more to the particularity of this piece. So, fancy title, The Teaching Artist Represents a Different Relationship Between Audience and Offering. In fact, it comes from we, not the impressive perfection of my technique, but in fact, what we get to share about something profoundly human that we have dedicated our lives to bringing to the finest fruition possible, but in fact, we get it to you as much from our hearts as we do from our hands. And we have engaged every possible technique to make that work. Indeed, when I worked with orchestras, we will often identify 50 different opportunities they have to enrich the quality of preparation, from what's in the program, to what's at the front door, to what happens in the lobby before the performance, what happens in the intermission, what happens after. In each of these 50 occasions, we have experimented to use teaching artist techniques to change and open up the audience experience without dumbing down the music. And for the musicians, in US conservatories now, there is an elective way to learn these skills while you're training to be a musician. There's only one conservatory, the Longy School of Music, where it is a graduation requirement. You cannot graduate from this conservatory unless you can demonstrate teaching artist capacity. It's heading that way. So we're changing their career aspirations, not for technical perfection, not just for the high-level job, but for a life of opening up wider, courageously, experimentally, what they know and can do. I want to end with a recognition of what an assignment this is. To balance the heavy burdens of the realities of orchestras and the complexity of performing, and the high aspiration to reach people in these deep ways. And this poem, with apologies to the translators, best captures that dichotomy, that paradox that lives in the arts. It's the last stanza of the poem, Two Tramps in Mud Time by Robert Frost. And it goes like this. But yield who will to their separation. My object in living is to unite my avocation and my vocation as my two eyes make one in sight. Only where love and need are one. And the work is play for mortal stakes. Is the work ever really done for heaven and the future's sakes? Thank you.